Hi friends, this is Dr. Prathap. In this part of the class, I will be dealing about interpretation of ABG, that is acid blood gas equation. So, interpretation of ABG, before going into interpretation of ABG, let us learn something about the basics of ABG. So, normal in the body, the pH of the body, it is well maintained. So, there are many mechanisms in the body which are maintaining the pH in the body. So the pH in the blood or the pH in the body fluids, it is maintained by the help of buffers. So there are some buffers in the body which will be maintaining the pH. So the normal pH, this will be ranging from 7.35 to 7.45. So this is the normal pH in the body. So the normal pH, if it is less than 7.35, if it is less than 7.35, this is called as acidosis. So this is called as acidosis. In acidosis, what is that seen is H plus ion concentration is increased. H plus ion is the proton. When the concentration of H plus ion increases, the fluid or the blood will become acidotic. If it is more than 7.45, this is called as alkalosis. So here the H plus or the proton concentration is decreased, or the major alkalotic ion is bicarbonate, so HCO3 is increased. So this normal range of very small range, that is 7.35 to 7.45, this is well maintained in the body with the help of buffers, out of which the most important buffer is the hemoglobin. So, which is maintaining this pH range. Number two, this is regulated very well in the body. It cannot always be maintained. There are many things that are happening in the body. There can be some problem in the body. If there is some problem in the body, there are some compensatory mechanisms happening. So, whenever there is a distortion or variation in this pH, this is well regulated by two important systems in the body. Number one, the renal system. Number two, the respiratory system. So what is normally happening is, whenever there is an acidosis or whenever there is an alkalosis because of renal problem, then the respiratory will try to compensate it. Or if there is some problem in the respiratory tree or in the respiratory system which is causing the variation in the pH, this is maintained or balanced by the renal system. For example, let us see if there is a renal failure in a patient. If there is a patient who is sustaining a renal failure, the excretion of ions will be defective. So in this, because of the failure of a renal system, the excretion will be defective. This leads to accumulation of acid in the body, that is proton ions, leading to acidosis. So this sort of acidosis is called as metabolic acidosis. So this is called as metabolic acidosis. Whenever there is an increased H plus concentration or loss of bicarbonate. This leads to acidosis. This acidosis is called as metabolic acidosis. In this state, the compensation of the pH. So here, because of this accumulation of H plus ions, what happens is the pH will fall down to below 7.35. The compensation in the body will happen with that of respiratory tree. So now our respiratory system will be stimulated. So the respiratory center will be stimulated. There is more and more breathing happening in the body, leading to washout of carbon dioxide. So the compensatory mechanism is decreased carbon dioxide in the body. This is decreased carbon dioxide in the body. So let us move into detail about the renal problem, into detail about the respiratory system, how it is well maintained. Okay, so first let us deal about the respiratory tree. So what changes will happen in the respiratory system? So what changes will cause that alteration in the pH? So normally PaCO2 is the one, or the partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the arterial tree. So this is meant by P stands for partial pressure. Partial pressure of carbon dioxide, small a stands for arterial tree or arterial circulation. So this carbon dioxide concentration in the arterial circulation decides the acidosis or alkalosis. So whenever this PaCO2 is increased, when this is increased, it means more and more carbon dioxide is getting accumulated in the body. So what is the normal function of the respiratory system? To take in oxygen, to breathe out carbon dioxide. So this will happen. So this is an abnormal thing that is happening. Increased carbon dioxide concentration in the body means the respiratory pathology is there. If we divide the respiratory system, we can divide this respiratory system into upper airways, lower airways, lung parenchyma, pleura. Beyond the pleura, there are many things which are very important and they will constitute the respiratory system. What are that is the vagus nerve which is connecting the respiratory tree to the central nervous system. So in the central nervous system, there is a respiratory center which is again a part of respiratory system. And in between these, the impulses that are coming from the respiratory center, they are carried through the vagus nerve to the respiratory muscles, which are again a part of respiratory system. So anything, this central mechanism for increased carbon dioxide concentration in the body is hypoventilation. So this is the central terminology which we use for increased carbon dioxide concentration. So this is what is leading to increased carbon dioxide concentration. So this PaCO2 increase leading because of hypoventilation. The causes of hypoventilation, it can be because of respiratory center depression. So the problem may be in the respiratory center. So when the center depresses because of any drugs like barbiturates, or because of some stroke, or because of some toxins or brain tumors, anything in the brain which is causing the center depression. Or this can be because of failure of respiratory muscle. So what is the major respiratory muscle? That is the diaphragm. When the diaphragm fails, respiratory muscle failure. Or this can be because of a vagus nerve pathology. So when the vagus nerve which is communicating the impulses between the respiratory center and the respiratory muscles, if this fails, then that can be a cause of hypoventilation. Or when there is a severe respiratory pathology like COPD, wherein the patient is not able to inspire and expire normally. So normal respiratory problems like pneumonia, normal respiratory problems like simple asthma, this will not cause hypoventilation. They will just impair the oxygen exchange, that all. So whenever we say the respiratory problems, like if there is, for example, say simple pneumonia, so what is the pneumonia doing? This pneumonia will be obstructing or this is hindering the exchange of oxygen from the alveoli into the arterial artery. So only the hypoxia will be there. There is no hypercapnia or no increased carbon dioxide. Okay. So only when there is hypoventilation, something damaging the respiratory center or the vagus nerve or the respiratory muscles, or severe respiratory pathology like COPD, very severe COPD, not in the initial stages of COPD, then only we can see this sort of increased PaCO2 which is causing acidosis. So if we reciprocate it again now, for example, see, if there is a metabolic acidosis, as we discussed previously, if there is a metabolic acidosis, what the body tries to do? The respiratory system will try to compensate for it. So this has to excrete more amount of PaCO2 outside the body. So how it can do? This will stimulate the respiratory center. Now the respiratory center is stimulated, more and more inspiration and expiration is happening. So the body will try to inspire more and expire more. So that is why when you see a patient of metabolic acidosis, that patient will be hyperventilating. So if you see the rhythm, then that respiration is called as Kussmaul's respiration. So in metabolic acidosis, compensation is respiratory alkalosis. So respiratory alkalosis, in order to make the respiratory alkalosis, the body has to take hyperventilation, breathe in more and breathe in out. So this respiration, which is hyperventilating more and more, that respiration is called as Kussmaul's respiration or Kussmaul's breathing. So this is how the respiratory center or the respiratory system will try to compensate. So if there is a primary pathology in the respiratory system, then that is called as respiratory acidosis or respiratory alkalosis. If there is a primary pathology in the renal system, that is called as metabolic acidosis or metabolic alkalosis. So to be more simple, whenever you see an ABG analysis or ABG paper, if the bicarbonate concentration is decreasing, that is metabolic acidosis. If the PaCO2 is increasing, that is respiratory acidosis. So I will make this more clear in the further part of the class. So which is primary, which is compensatory, how to analyze them or how to differentiate between primary and compensatory, I will tell you. Okay, then the renal tree or the renal system, how it handles the pH or how it handles the ions. So if you see in the renal tree, the body, the whatever the blood that is entering into the nephron, this is filtered in the glomerulus. So the glomerular filtration which is coming into the nephron, into the tubules of the nephron, so majority, for example, if you say some 100 ions of bicarbonate, they are in the filtered glomerular filtrate, majority of them, they are reabsorbed back into the body. So only a part of bicarbonate that is filtered is excreted out. So for this, how this happens, how the reabsorption of bicarbonate happens is, in the proximal tubule, the reabsorption, majority of the reabsorption, more than 70% of reabsorption will occur in the proximal tubule. Then after the proximal tubule, there is loop of Henle, and then the distal tubule and the collecting duct. In the distal tubule and in the collecting duct, this bicarbonate, this is absorbed into the circulation, and chloride is secreted out. So the renal handling in the collecting duct, in order to make the body pH normal, here the H+ concentration, H+ will be excreted into the urine. How this happens is, I will say. So in the distal convoluted tubule, if you say this is the distal convoluted tubule, so this is the tubular end where the urine is moving out. The sodium that is present in the distal convoluted tubule filtrate, this should be taken back into the body in exchange of this sodium in the distal convoluted tubule, the H+ will be secreted out, making the urine acidic. So why the urine is acidic is, in the distal convoluted tubule, sodium reabsorption into the circulation, this is compensated by secretion of H+ in the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting duct, making the urine acidic. So this is about the renal handling of pH. So now this is about the basic pathogen, basic pathology, or basic things about the ABG or about the pH of the body. Now let us move. So what is there? So how should we interpret an ABG analysis if a paper is given to you to analyze or interpret that ABG? How to analyze this? Okay. So this, before going to that, let me say you something about an important equation in ABG analysis that is called as Henderson Hasselbalch's equation. So this is the central thing. So this is how this equation tells many things about the ABG or about the pH in the body, how the bicarbonate and the PaCO2 or the carbon dioxide concentration, they will reflect the pH levels. So the equation is, pH is equal to 6.1 plus log bicarbonate ion concentration in millimoles per liter by PaCO2 in millimeters of mercury, PaCO2 into 0.0301. So this is the equation. So pH is equal to 6.1 plus log bicarbonate concentration by PaCO2 into 0.0301. So what we should know from this equation is, if you see pH, this is changing with bicarbonate concentration directly. So pH here, it is directly proportional to bicarbonate concentration. Okay. So because it is in the numerator, this is directly proportional. So what do you mean by this directly proportional to bicarbonate concentration? Whenever the bicarbonate concentration increases, the normal bicarbonate in the body is 22 to 26 millimoles per liter. This is the normal bicarbonate concentration. Whenever this bicarbonate concentration increases, for example, if you say the bicarbonate concentration increases to 40, the pH will also increase. So what do you mean by increase in pH? pH more than 7.345 is equal to alkalosis. So that is a metabolic alkalosis. Whenever the bicarbonate concentration decreases, the pH will also decrease. pH will also decrease. So that is called as metabolic acidosis. Okay. Number two, what we should infer from this equation is pH is inversely proportional to PCO2. Yes. So inversely proportional to, because PCO2 is in the denominator, pH is inversely proportional to PCO2. So inversely proportional to PCO2 means whenever the PaCO2 increases, pH will fall. So if PaCO2 increases, normal PaCO2 is 40 millimeters of mercury. So this is the normal PaCO2. Whenever it is more than 40, so then this increases, the pH will fall down, leading to acidosis. So increased PaCO2 is acidosis, decreased PaCO2 is alkalosis. So this is what is the inference from from the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. So now let us go into the interpretation of ABG. For that, let me again say you about the normal values. Normal pH is equal to 7.35 to 7.45. Normal bicarbonate is equal to 22 to 26 millimoles per liter. Normal PaCO2 is equal to 40 millimeters of mercury. Usually it is around 20 to 40. If it is more than 40, it is increased. 20 to 40, for practical purposes, let us take 20 to 40. With this background, let us see how to interpret now. So if an ABG is given like this, so now you are seeing in a patient in the background of some clinical history. So interpretation of ABG should always be done in the background of clinical history only. Without knowing the clinical history, we cannot interpret the ABG. For example, if you see, here is an example, a patient of diabetes who has come to you. So a diabetic individual who has come to you with hyperventilation, he is having breathlessness from the past 3 or 4 hours. He has been sick for the past 3 or 4 hours with acute abdominal pain. He has landed into your casualty. Now you are examining the patient. The patient is hyperventilating. When you saw the patient, he is having hyperventilation. When you take an ABG of the patient, here are the values. So let us interpret what are these values. The pH of this patient is 7.1. HCO3 of this patient is 12 millimoles per liter. Then the PaCO2 here is 45 millimeters of mercury. So with this things, with these three things, so what do we analyze there? How do we analyze this ABG? So what is the problem that is happening in this patient? Is it the acidosis? Is it the alkalosis? So for that, we should analyze in a stepwise way. In the first step, what we have to do is see the pH of the patient. See the pH of the patient. So the pH of the patient should be first seen. Here, if you see, the pH of the patient is 7.1. So 7.1, is it acidosis or alkalosis? This is acidosis. So once we see the pH of the patient, the second step is very, very important. Which is primary, which is compensatory? So in order to know that, which will correlate with the pH is primary, which will not correlate with the pH is compensatory. Okay, so let me make you more easy. So here the PaCO2 is it is around 10. Let it be. It is around 10. This is 10. So don't take it as 45 here. So the pH is 7.1. Bicarbonate is 12. PaCO2 is 10. In the step 2, what we have to do is, so be very very attentive here. So this is very important. In the step 2, this is the central thing. So whatever the value which correlate with the pH is primary. So here HCO3 is 12 millimoles of millimoles per liter. So is it increased or decreased? This is decreased. Bicarbonate levels decreased is acidosis or alkalosis? Decreased bicarbonate is acidosis. So this is acidosis. PaCO2, is it increased or decreased? This is decreased. So decreased PaCO2, is it acidosis or alkalosis? Alkalosis. So this is alkalosis. So whatever the thing in these two values, whichever the thing that correlate with the pH is primary event. Which is correlating with the pH now? Bicarbonate. So the primary event is bicarbonate. Primary event because of bicarbonate is called metabolic or respiratory? Metabolic. So this is a metabolic acidosis with step 3, the compensation. Step 3, the compensation. So what is the compensation? This should be compensation should be always for metabolic acidosis. Compensation should be respiratory alkalosis. So here the compensation is happening respiratory alkalosis. So interpretation of this ABG is metabolic acidosis with compensatory respiratory alkalosis. So up to this point, this is very simple actually. So this is up to this point, this is simple and very easy also actually. Then the next steps in interpretation, which we will be going to discuss, they may be more complicated. Before going into that, let us discuss one more example so that you can remember things well. So here is a patient who has come to your casualty. He has been sick and is unconscious, has brought to your casualty. So when you have done his pH, when you have done this ABG analysis, the pH of the patient is 7.6. The PCO2 of this patient is 12 millimeters of mercury. So here the pH is 12. Sorry. The bicarbonate concentration of this patient is 48 millimoles per liter. The PCO2 of this patient is 60 millimeters of mercury. So this is the equation. Now this is the ABG analysis that is given before you. So now interpret this. Step 1. Whether it is step 1 should be interpretation of pH. Is it acidosis or alkalosis? Raised pH. It is alkalosis. So what is the primary event? Step 2 should be analysis of the primary event. So the primary event, PaCO2 is increased. Increased PaCO2 means acidosis or alkalosis? This is acidosis. Increased PaCO2 means the carbon dioxide concentration is increasing, that is acidosis. Bicarbonate, is it increased or decreased? Increased bicarbonate. So increased bicarbonate means this is alkalosis. So now the primary event is bicarbonate, that is metabolic alkalosis. Step 3, the compensation is respiratory acidosis. So here the analysis of this is the metabolic alkalosis with respiratory acidosis. So this is quite simple actually, but so we are just seeing here whether it is a primary event or secondary event, but we are not seeing here whether the compensation is adequate or inadequate. So for anything, there should be an adequate compensation. Remember one thing, the body will never try to overcorrect anything. this may undercorrect if there is some pathology in the body. So if, for example, if you see a patient of respiratory, a patient of metabolic acidosis is coming to you, he might be having some respiratory pathology. He might be a patient of COPD, you think so. So in spite of body having metabolic acidosis, the respiratory system in that patient is not normal. So if it is not normal, he may not correct it normally. So it may be under correction. Yeah. So for example, if you see some patient with respiratory acidosis, here the renal system should try to compensate for that. So it should make the body metabolic alkalosis. So there should be increased HCO3 concentration in the body. So this should happen actually. If there is a renal failure, it may not compensate correctly. So the next step we have to know is, what about the compensation? So up to this point, I think you will be very clear. Step 1, step 2 and step 3. So in the next step, what we have to do is, so what is the actual compensation? Is it compensating normally or not? So whether the compensation is normal or not. So in this fourth step, let us see about the compensation. So this compensation, this is based on many equations. So we should remember some formulas. So for compensation, first, if you are seeing a metabolic acidosis. So in metabolic acidosis, what is the primary thing that is happening? Decreased bicarbonate in the body. What is the compensation that should happen? Compensation that is happening in the body when there is a decreased bicarbonate and acidosis, respiratory system should try to this should try to wash out more and more carbon dioxide. So the carbon dioxide should decrease. So that is respiratory alkalosis should happen. Metabolic acidosis, the compensation is respiratory alkalosis. Respiratory alkalosis means decreased PaCO2 should happen. So what is the formula that is formula for compensation here is the PaCO2 of the patient. The PaCO2 of the patient, this should be calculated by a formula like this: 1.5 into bicarbonate concentration plus 8 plus or minus 2. This is the compensation, or this is the equation that is used to calculate the compensation. Let us see this with an example. Okay, so going back to the previous example where the patient is a diabetic, has come to us with hyperventilation, that is Kussmaul's respiration. There the pH is somewhere around 7.1. PCO2 and HCO3 we have calculated that is around 12 and this is around 10. So this is the example we have given previously. So if I suppose this is what we have given in the first example, let us see if this is the ABG analysis of the patient. Let us see here whether the compensation, the PaCO2, is it compensated or not compensated. Okay. So PaCO2, according to this formula, PaCO2 of the patient should be 1.5 into bicarbonate. 1.5 into bicarbonate, that is 12, plus 8 plus or minus 2, or we can, the 8 plus or minus 2 means 6 or 10. We can add this with 6 or 10. If we add this with 6, so 1.5 into 12 is 18, plus 6 is equal to 24, plus 10 is equal to 28. So this should be 24 to 28. So the PCO2 concentration, the PCO2 in the body should be 24 to 28. This should lie somewhere between 24 and 28. If it is more than 28, that is under correction. If it is less than 24, this is over correction. Remember, body will never try to over correct. So this is what is a wrong ABG analysis. So this is a wrong ABG analysis. So body will never try to overcorrect like this. So this is, for example, we have taken just example, not the exact values. This is a wrong ABG analysis. This should lie between 24 to 28. So this is the formula we use for calculating the metabolics, for calculating the PaCO2 in patients with metabolic acidosis. So this is a compensatory formula. Then we can also be, without using this formula also, we can calculate and we can see a rough estimate can be done. For every 1 millimole per liter decrease in bicarbonate. So when the bicarbonate decreases, for every 1 millimole decrease in bicarbonate, the PaCO2 should decrease. So this should decrease by 1.25 millimeters of mercury. So this should decrease by 1.25 millimeters of mercury. See, in the same thing, in the same example, 7.1, 10 and what 12, we have taken this as values previously. So if you see in the same thing, so here the bicarbonate concentration is 12. So bicarbonate normally it should be 22. So here there is 10 decrease in bicarbonate is 10. So for every 1 millimole there should be decrease in 1.25. For 10 it is 12.5. So now it should decrease to 12.5. Normal PaCO2 is 40. So 40 minus 12.5 is somewhere around 27.5, which falls in this range only. Okay, so this is very easy thing. So if you don't remember this formula, we can see like this. Okay, so this is about compensation in metabolic acidosis. If it is in the metabolic alkalosis, compensation in the metabolic alkalosis, take down this. Compensation in metabolic alkalosis. So here what is the central thing happening? Increase in bicarbonate. For every 1 millimole increase in bicarbonate concentration, the PaCO2 should increase or decrease? So you remember this blindly. Anywhere, whenever there is an increase in one, opposite thing will also increase only. So what we speak is, for metabolic acidosis there is respiratory alkalosis. So when we see this, so if I want to make you remember this more and more, if you see the Heselson-Enterbach equation previously, pH there is equal to 6.1 plus log of bicarbonate by carbon dioxide into some value. Okay, so if you see this only, if you see like this, if you take this PCO2 to the opposite side, PCO2 is always proportional to bicarbonate. Yes? So if you take this denominator to the opposite side, so this is PCO2 is always proportional to bicarbonate. That is what is what we are writing here. So don't get confused. Whenever there is increased bicarbonate, there is increase in PCO2. Here if you see, there is decrease in bicarbonate, there is decrease in PCO2. So that is very simple. So this is based on the SSNH equation only again. So for every 1 millimole of increase in bicarbonate, the PCO2 will increase by 0.75 in metabolic alkalosis. In metabolic acidosis it is 1.25, remember this number. In metabolic alkalosis it is 0.75. Okay. Then for respiratory acidosis, in respiratory conditions, compensations are calculated based on whether the condition is acute or chronic. In acute respiratory acidosis, see what happens in acute respiratory acidosis. Respiratory acidosis means increase in PCO2 concentration. So what should be the compensation? HCO3 should also increase, which means alkalosis. So for every 1 millimeters of mm of mercury increase in PCO2, bicarbonate should increase by 0.1. Here, in chronic conditions, for every 1 millimeters of mercury increase in PCO2, the compensation bicarbonate should increase by 0.4. This should increase by 0.4. For respiratory alkalosis, again, whether it is acute or chronic, in acute respiratory alkalosis, PCO2, because it is alkalosis, it is decreasing. For every 1 millimeters of mercury decrease in PCO2, HCO3 should decrease by 0.2 here. This is 0.1, this is 0.2. Chronic, it is same as that of 0.4, same as that of acidosis, chronic respiratory acidosis. So same as that of that. So for every 1 millimeter of mercury decrease in PCO2, bicarbonate should decrease by 0.4. So this is about the compensation. So this is the fourth step. The first step is based on the pH, whether it is acidosis or alkalosis. The next we have to see, well, in the second step we have to see the primary event. The third step you have to see the compensatory mechanism. The fourth step you have to see whether the compensation has happened normally or not. Then, if you are encountering a respiratory condition, if you are encountering an alkalosis, therein's the matter. There is no need to worry again. If you are encountering an acidotic condition, if you are seeing an acidotic condition, we have to divide this again into a normal anionic gap acidosis or an increased anion gap acidosis. So before knowing into these things, let us see what is this anion gap at all. So what is this anion gap at all? So whenever we take out the blood from our body and estimate, we are usually estimating some important ions only. So if you see the serum electrolyte reports in your hospital, you'll be seeing only important things. You'll be calculating sodium, you'll be calculating potassium, you'll be calculating chloride, and in the AB analysis you'll get a bicarbonate. So this is what we are actually calculating, right? So this is sodium, potassium, chloride, and bicarbonate. These are the normal things which are calculating. These are the two cations. So I think you might be knowing what is cation. The positive charged ion is cation. These are the two negative anions. So negative charge, they are called anions. So we are calculating only this. In the cations, if you see, sodium is the major cation in the blood. Potassium is, majority of the potassium is there in the intracellular thing. So in the blood it is around some 4 to 5 only. So that is very negligible. So anion gap means, so this anion gap is what is meant by this anion gap is the unmeasured anions in the blood. So we are measuring chloride and bicarbonate only. There are some other anions like phosphate, some anion like sulfate, albumin, organic anions. So there are many things in the body. So all these things we are not measuring with the help of the standard electrolyte measurements or with the help of standard ABG analysis. So this amount of unmeasured anions in the body is called as anion gap. Normally in the body, if you cut our blood and see anywhere in the body, the cation should always be equal to anions. There should be no gap in between this. Because we are not able to measure this, that is why we are seeing on the paper there is a difference between sodium, difference between potassium, between the cations and the anions, not in the blood. Okay. So this anion gap, this is measured by the sodium concentration minus chloride plus bicarbonate concentration. So this is the formula we use. For all practical purposes, we are using this formula only. Sodium being a very negligible ion, we are not in the extracellular fluid, we are not taking the potassium there. Sodium minus chloride concentration plus bicarbonate concentration. So this is usually 10 to 12. So this is usually 10 to 12. Whenever that this anion gap is more than 12, then that is called as increased anion gap acidosis. When it is less than 10, that is called as normal. So normal, it is between 10 to 12, that is called as normal anionic gap acidosis. So let us see why this increased anion gap happens in the body. So why this increased anion happens in the body? So this is very simple actually. So whenever there is an increase in this pool, then that will increase the anion. Yeah. So this pool can be increased whenever we supplement some organic anions from the into the circulation. So we cannot circulate or we cannot supplement this via the intravenous route, right? So if some pathology is happening in the body, say for example, there is a diabetic individual who has got hyperglycemia, uncontrolled hyperglycemia. He is going into a state called diabetic ketoacidosis, DKA. So diabetic ketoacidosis. What is happening in this diabetic ketoacidosis? Ketone bodies are the organic anions which are there, they are going and entering into the blood. So now the pool of the unmeasured anions, they are increasing or decreasing? They are increasing. So they are supplemented by some other ions. So diabetic ketoacidosis. So the ketone bodies, they are increasing in the body, they cannot be measured. These ketone bodies cannot be measured. So if they are not measured, the anion gap rate increases. Or if there is a lactic acidosis, so the lactic acid is going into the pool now, it is increasing the anion. Or if there is some toxins, for example, say if methanol toxin, methanol is taken, or ethanol is taken, or ethylene oxide is taken, some toxins if they are ingested, they are again anions. This increases the anion gap. This will increase the anion. So if you see the examples for increased anionic gap acidosis is diabetic ketoacidosis, lactic acidosis, toxins like ethylene oxide, methanol, etc. So these are number four. This can also be because of renal failure. See what happens in renal failure. So our renal system or the kidney, it is designed in such a way it should excrete all the byproducts or all the abnormal things in the body. There you should excrete all the byproducts of metabolism. So if the renal failure is there, the byproducts of metabolism cannot be excreted in the urine, they will pull up in the body, increasing the anions. So the anion gap will increase. So these are the four conditions which will lead to increased anionic gap acidosis. Normal anionic gap acidosis, this is seen in two important conditions. There are many conditions, but what is more important is number one, renal tubular acidosis. So this is one condition where we'll see normal anionic gap acidosis. Number two, this is seen in diarrhea, where there is loss of all the ions from the in the GI tract. So this is about acidosis, how to interpret and divide this into normal anionic gap and increased anionic gap. So in the step 5, you have to see the anion gap. If the anion gap is increased, these are the conditions. If the anion gap is decreased, this is normal. These are the conditions. So this is about the interpretation of ABG. So here we have learnt about the HH, Henderson-Hasselbalch equation. Learnt how to interpret that, what are the compensatory mechanisms that are happening in the body, how to calibrate the compensation, whether the compensation is normal or it is undercompensated, and then about the anion gap. So with this, end this video. Thank you for watching. So for more videos, you can subscribe to our channel, Conceptual Medicine by Dr. Prathap Bingi. Thank you.